everyone, it's Kim over at the Homeschooling Grammy. I'm coming to you today with another collab. This time it's being hosted by myself and also Ingrid over at Mommy and Mia Homeschool Chronicles. And the name of this collab is called His Steadfast Love. What we're going to be doing is answering 7 faith-based questions. Some of them include scripture, some of them are just questions that Ingrid and I have come up with. And so anyways, this is an open collab, so if you're interested, you can go ahead and answer these questions also. I will put all of the questions down in the description box so that you can go ahead and print them off or however you would like to go ahead and answer them yourself. And I will also put a link to the playlist and a link to Ingrid's channel, Mommy and Mia Homeschool Chronicles. Please make sure to go check out her channel. She's really awesome. I just love her and Mia. Really sweet people. So if this is something that you're interested in, please stick around and we'll get started. Okay, let's do question number 1. What is your favorite verse about love in the Bible and why? So my favorite verse is from the Song of Solomon, chapter 3, verse 4. Scarcely had I passed them when I found him whom my soul loves. When I just think of the magnitude of the love that the Lord has for us, that he actually seeks us out, and that we were created to love him and to be with him, it's just mind-blowing to me. That amidst everything in our lives, it doesn't matter what we've done, it could be anything, and it does not matter. All that he wants is for us to accept the Lord Jesus as our personal Savior, and it wipes our slate clean. It doesn't mean that we'll never sin again, but it does mean that we are in a right relationship with God. That's mind-blowing to me. I recently read, maybe a couple months ago, it was a little meme, and it really fit me, because, you know, as broken as I am in the world's eyes, and even in my own eyes, I think for myself, I see all the flaws each and every day, how flaw-filled I am, and how I have to just, you know, trust in the Lord and have him make me into the creature that he wants me to be. But anyways, I had saw this meme and I thought, how cool is this? It says, you are allowed to be both a masterpiece and a work in progress simultaneously. And that's really awesome that in the Lord's eyes, we are his masterpiece. Amidst all of our struggles and all of the craziness that goes on in our lives, and yet we are his masterpiece. Casting Crowns has a song where in the song it talks about how he already's there at the end of our lives. I mean, imagine that for a minute. God is already there waiting for us at the end of our life. He already knows the end. He was there at the beginning, but he also knows the end, and that's pretty exciting to me. So anyways, let's go on to the next question. Okay, question number 2. Have you ever been shown an act of love that was sent from God? Yeah. Jesus Christ dying on the cross for me. That was the biggest act of love that God has ever sent. Sending his son Jesus to die for me. Me, a person who has, you know, no matter what I've done, no matter where I'm at, where my in my life, no matter what I'm thinking, no matter what I'm feeling, no matter what I've said, no matter, you know, no matter what I may have done in this life, Jesus still loves me, and Jesus still sent his son to die for me. And I don't think that there's any greater love in this world than that. And how do I know this? Because his word tells me so. And I'm going to read another scripture to you. It's from Romans 8, 38 and 39. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present or things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. So nothing. There is not anything that can separate us from the Lord Jesus Christ except ourselves. Because we are given the choice. God does not make us accept Him. God does not make us believe on the name of Jesus Christ. That is something that you must decide on your own. But how beautiful is that? When you accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you are forever His, and there is not anything in all of creation that can separate you from that love. All right, question number 3. If there weren't any boundaries to what you could do for another person, what would it be? Well, I would give them my salvation. Yeah. If I could do that and still keep my own, you know, like sharing a cookie, you know, and give somebody a piece of your cookie. But it doesn't work that way. And then I got to thinking to myself, if the maker of all creation has offered us this free gift and people still don't take the free gift, why are they going to take it from me? My biggest prayer is that people will come to Christ. I have so many people in my life, the majority of my family actually, that don't know Jesus. And it's heartbreaking and it's hard. I just pray every day, every single day. I know that God works miracles because my mother is in heaven. She did wait till, you know, the last minute really. It was in her last months of life that's when she came to Christ. But if you're gonna wait until then, don't do that, because we're not guaranteed tomorrow. You're not guaranteed 2 minutes from now. So if you have been struggling back and forth and God has been talking to you saying, no, today is the day, listen to the Lord. Listen to His calling to you, because He wants you with Him in the next world for everlasting life. And it is only found through Jesus Christ. I just implore you to talk to me. You can ask me a question in the description box if you want to. You can message me however you would like, and I would be happy to talk to you about that. That is my biggest thing that I would wish that I could share. I mean, I can share the good news with you. I can tell you about it, but only you can make that decision. I can't make it for you as much as I would like to, and I can't give you a piece of my salvation like I'm sharing, you know, a chocolate chip cookie, which I really like a lot, but yeah, I can't share it. So I'm going to read a little piece of scripture for you. It's from John 12:48. There is a judge for the one who rejects me and does not accept my words. The very words I have spoken will condemn them at the last day. The scripture is pretty clear. For the person that does not accept God's words, accept Jesus Christ, there will come a day where we will all stand before judgment. It's just heartbreaking for me to even think about. So, anyways, we'll go on to the next question. Okay, on to number 4, and this is actually a piece of scripture. Matthew 22:37-39 says, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor like yourself." What does loving your neighbor look like to you? Okay, so for me, loving my neighbor means sometimes, I mean, loving people, they may seem unlovable to the world even. And sometimes those kinds of people can be in your family, in your life. And it can be very difficult. It can be difficult to try to see the world through their eyes and that's what we all need to try to do, is to see the world through somebody else's eyes. Because sometimes how people behave or things that they say or things that they do, sometimes it's because of their circumstances. Sometimes it's because they don't know any better. Sometimes it's because their life has been so hard and they don't know that there is a Father in heaven that loves us unconditionally. They've been loved with conditions, and they've been loved, sorry, but they have just, they're broken. Like, they're just broken for whatever reason. It could be from their infancy. It could be from, you just don't know. And I can say this because I've been a foster parent, and I've seen some horrible things. I've seen some really bad stuff. And sometimes those scars never, ever go away. They just never do. But if they know the Lord and they seek out Jesus Christ in their life, then He can make all things new again. And it's not an instantaneous better. It's a growing process. I know, because I'm a growing process. I think many of us are. And that's just life, and that's reality. And God didn't promise us that we were going to have an easy life. He didn't promise us that things are going to instantaneously change when you become a believer in Jesus Christ. Just the opposite, actually. He actually says there will be trouble. So you can be rest assured that there will be trouble. So I try with the help of the Lord to put myself into other people's shoes. And a lot of times, it is hard sometimes, because sometimes for myself, I know that for me, hurt comes out in anger. And so what I work on is trying really hard to let God work through me. Let Him be the one who speaks in a situation, and giving it over to Him before I even have a conversation, because, you know, sometimes you open your mouth before you really should. But anyways, I'm going to read another scripture to you, and this is from Ephesians 4:32, and it says, "Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, as in Christ God forgave you." So God's word says that we are to forgive others. Forgiving others doesn't mean that we continue letting somebody else hurt you or do wrong things to you or whatever the case may be. Forgiving is a freeing of ourselves, that we are able to rest and give it to God. It's handing it over. And just leaving it to the Lord to fix whatever it is, because I know for myself personally, with my personality, is I always like to fix things, and sometimes we can't fix things, and that's been a real learning process for me, that there are some things that can't be fixed, and the greatest physician, He's the one that will fix it, and not me. Okay, so number 5, 1 Corinthians 13, 4-7 says, "Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Choose from above those you feel you do well, and why, and also choose those that you miss the mark on, and why you do." I don't think that I do many of them well. I may have times where I do a little bit better, but I don't think that I ever do any of them well. I think that through the Lord that I am doing much better, absolutely much better, but I never feel like I do them well. And that's, I don't know if that's a good thing or not, that I don't feel like I do them well. But anyways, I mean, I can see myself as far as, like there's been times throughout my life that I've been irritable, I've been resentful, resentful of circumstances or stuff that has happened. But I know that through God, I'll be an overcomer of all of these things. That with His love and His mercy and His grace and His forgiveness, that I can overcome these things. And it takes time to do that. I know that I'm different today than I was yesterday, and I'm different yesterday than I was the day before that. And life can be hard, and it's not always fair, as everybody likes to say. Actually, in our recent vacation Bible school, you know, we talked to the kids about that, and our pastor talked about, you know, how kids really, I mean, they already kind of understand that, don't they, about what's fair and what's not fair. That's not fair. You know, she got two cookies and I only got one. But God is fair. And that's a beautiful thing, that God is fair and that His ways are good. And that everything that happens to us is for a reason, that He is orchestrating all of this and for our good. So I'm going to go ahead and read another scripture. It's from Romans 8:28. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to His purpose. Isn't that a beautiful thing, that He is working it all out for good? It doesn't matter what the circumstance is on any given day, good, bad, indifferent, God is working it out for good. In the end, it's all going to be for good. In the end, those of us who know Jesus will prayerfully get to hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant." That's just amazing to me. Number 6. Psalm 119:30 says, "I have chosen the way of faithfulness. I set your rules before me." How do you live out faithfulness in your life? Is your faith based on rules? Well, I think I live by choosing faith. And I really do think it's a choice. You can choose to trust God, or you can choose not to trust God. And that's for the big things and the little things. Not just, you know, it's for everything. All the choices that we make. Are we going to choose to trust God? Are we going to look to His Word? Are we going to read His Word to seek out His truths for our lives? The Bible is very much alive. And the Word of God is a compass for everything that we do. So I like to spend time in His Word. I try to make that my first priority over reading anything else, actually. If I don't make time to read the Bible, then I have really no business reading anything else, is kind of my mindset. And I work on being obedient. What is God asking of me? What is He asking me to do? And I think through our obedience, we show our faithfulness to God. Psalm 102:25 through 27 says, "Of old you laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you will remain. They will all wear out like a garment. You will change them like a robe, and they will pass away, but you are the same, and your years have no end." That's just amazing to me. God never changes. Never. Never. People can say whatever they want to say as far as you know, people, you know, you hear people say that, you know, well, that's old-fashioned way of thinking, or that's, you know, well, people don't do that anymore. But God's word, it tells you he doesn't change. He's the same yesterday, he's the same today, he'll be the same again tomorrow. And trusting him, being obedient to him, loving him, and he's here with us all the way. All right, last question, question number 7. Matthew 5, 13 through 16 says, "You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." So, those two components are vital in Christians, in a Christian's life. What does it mean to be the salt and the light? So I'm going to answer this in two sections. So I'm going to start with the salt. It means, in essence, to be the flavor of Jesus Christ to the world. Our saltiness actually is the riches that only can be found in Jesus. In ancient times, like, salt was actually something that was very valuable, was of great worth, and you know, if you had salt, it was a big deal in ancient times. And that's like us. We are of great worth to the Lord. I mean, we are of such great value that he sent his only son, Jesus Christ, to die for us on the cross. And by being the salt of the earth, by our example, people will see something different in us. If we are being the salt of the earth, people are seeing a different, something that is different about us, makes them curious about us. Like, why is that person have joy? Why is that person making these kinds of decisions? The saltiness is a direct reflection of our relationship with Jesus. And in the saltiness, I guess you could say, it's kind of like, I'm kind of looking at my notes because I wanted to make sure how to describe this or to explain this, but saltiness, if we are the salt of the earth, then we're showing people a different way, showing people through our actions, our words, what makes us different being in Jesus, and that difference makes other people thirst for that difference. Does that make any sense? Just like if you were to, you know, down some salt, kind of gross, but if you were to down some salt, you'd get really thirsty, wouldn't you? It's the same idea. Our saltiness, our difference, our way of life, and our faithfulness and our obedience to God and our love for the Lord and all of those things, and our outlook on life because we are trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ, and people are looking at us from the outside and they're saying, I want some of that. I want some of that living water that this person has. So they are thirsting for what we have. So in essence, yeah, that's my explanation of us being the salt of the earth. Okay, so on to the second part of the question, which was, what does it mean to be the light of the world? And I believe it means just to show the love of Jesus to the world through us. We are the light in the darkness of our world, and sometimes that means going outside of your comfort zone, going outside of your Christian circle, going and being with people that might not be the same as you are for whatever and whatever reason it might be that they're not the same as you are, because ultimately we all are the same. But stepping out of your Christian circle. Not just going to church, because, you know, anybody can go to church. You know, there's, you know, that saying, you know, being, you know, just because you're in church doesn't mean you're any more of a Christian than, you know, if you're standing in a garage makes you a car, kind of that kind of thing. But to be out there and to show people the love of God and to love on people and to help people and to give of yourself and just to be there to people of all walks of life, that just a kind word, you know, like in social media, you see all kinds of negativity. Wouldn't it be wonderful if instead of all the negativity, you had something good to say every day about somebody? Doesn't matter who. Choose a person. Have something good to say about them. You know, tell them how nice they look, or, you know, whatever. There's numerous things that you could do. But I think that that's what it means to be the light, just to show them the love of Jesus Christ, and that lives really are transformed through Jesus. I know this firsthand. Recently, a really good friend of mine came to the Lord, somebody who thought they were worthless, and, you know, they're not. This person is not worthless. Doesn't matter what you've done. Doesn't matter where you've been. Doesn't matter, you know, whatever you might be thinking or someone has told you or whatever. What really matters is that the Lord loves you. The Lord wants you. The Lord created you, and He created beauty inside and out. So, actually, once the light is out there, it can never be put out again. So that's the beautiful part too. And John 1:5 says, "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." So once you show people the light of Jesus Christ, it can never be put out. Those words, that action, whatever it is that you have done to make that other person's life better, can never be put out again. And even though you may not think it's a big deal, you just never know what kind of impact that you can have on the people around you. Okay, everybody, that's a wrap for this collab. Those were some hard questions, some really, really hard questions. Yeah, okay, Ingrid, we outdid ourselves with those questions. But anyways, I hope you enjoyed this collab. I hope that it blesses you. And like I said earlier, feel free to comment down below. Feel free to message me. You know, feel free to reach out to me. I'm on Instagram. I'm here on YouTube. I'd be happy to talk to you. Make sure that you check out Ingrid's channel, Mommy and Mia Homeschool Chronicles. Like I said earlier, her channel is in the description box along with a link to the playlist. So anyways, I hope to see you again soon, and thanks so much. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit that notification bell so you'll get notified when I upload.